Okay, hey sinners, my name is Kat.
And I'm Jess, and today we'll be talking about Deceived by the Gargoyles by Lillian Lark.
Alright, so this book is a standalone. It is within the same universe as Stalked by the Kraken, which I don't think either of us have read yet, but it is on the list. And it is another monster. Oh wait, no, that is another... Sorry, that is another monster romance by Lillian Lark. Yeah, just like a small disclaimer, we both read this book a year ago, like almost to the day. So we're just gonna try to reconstruct the plot, because I think it'd be really funny just to see how it goes.
I know I don't remember that much, so this will be a journey for sure.
I remember like the big important pieces, but even some of those are a little sketchy. I do think we're both a little sleep deprived, so I just think it's gonna be fun. It's gonna be a fun time.
Yeah. Let's go into a plot summary. Kind of. We're gonna try.
Okay, so we start out with our main character, whose name is Grace. She is a plus-size witch, this is our first, like, review of, like, a female main character, as well as, like, a plus-size main character, which is really fun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she works in the library, and she does restorations of artifacts and, like, other things, using her magic. And we also meet her friend, Amelia.
During this time, or, like, before this, Grace goes to see a matchmaker, because she wants to find love, you know? So she goes to the matchmaker and she's a little skeptical, but the matchmaker's like, I got this, don't worry. Things happen, the matchmaker sets her up, and Grace goes on the date with this guy named Elliot. And when she arrives at their like location that they like are designated to go for their date, Elliot's just like a nice looking guy, suave, well-dressed, all that. He's like charming and sweet, and she just like really enjoys their time together.
So I think a big part of this is that Amelia has very specific requirements that she wants met in, like, a partner. And so she gives that list to the matchmaker just so that she can find her, oh my god, quote-unquote, perfect match. But yeah, she goes on a date. They really vibe well. I think they go on, like, a couple dates before they start kind of, like, getting serious. She's like, I really like her. No, she's like, I really like him. And he's like, I really like her. But, like, since this book is from, like, a dual perspective, pretty soon we see that Elliot is, like, hiding something. We see that he has, like, another partner. Because... Do you remember any of this?
No, I really don't.
It's, like, chapter 4. And it's, like, hang on, I'll find the quote. Sorry. You lubed your tail up? God, you're gonna kill me. So, like, we see pretty soon that he's, like, hiding something. Yeah, but Grace is still pretty interested because she doesn't know anything. And I don't really know how they figure it out. Does he just tell her?
I think so. Oh my gosh. I think, for now, we're just gonna say she finds out that he's a gargoyle. I think he tells her. I think they're walking back or something after a date or something, and he's like, I need to tell you something. I'm a gargoyle. You know, I'm not human. I wear this, like, glimmer, and I'm a gargoyle. And she's like, oh, okay. I'm on, like, chapter 6, and I think this gargoyle is a smart dresser. By chapter 6, she knows he's a gargoyle, so...
Yeah.
Don't know how it happens, but somewhere along the way. Yeah, anyway, she finds out he's a gargoyle, and she seems pretty okay with it.
I think Elliot tells Grace that she's gonna meet his brothers because they're getting kind of serious, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they go on a date in chapter 10, and then chapter 11, they go to the chapel, and Grace meets Broderick while she's there, right?
Yes.
And that was on accident. She wasn't supposed to, but, like, she hides, and then he finds her.
Yeah. Do you remember that? He, like, sniffs her out.
Yeah.
But at this point, she thinks that they're all, like, siblings rather than partners.
After that, Grace goes downstairs, like, in the chapel, and she sees, like, Alex, who's an ogre, and then while she's there, it's like not really relevant to the plot, but she does see that. And then while she's there, Alistair like comes and she's like, oh, hello.
Yeah.
<She's>
like... I think it's here that she's like, not brothers at all, lovers. And she feels like very blindsided and like kind of lied to. Yeah, disrespected. Yeah, so they talk it out. Elliot's like, you're exactly what we need. We're going through something. You're gonna help fix us, kind of.
Elliot's just like, yeah, Grace belongs with us. Yeah, and Broderick is like, we should probably, like, Alistair, we should probably listen to him. Like, I could see the potential, like, after meeting Grace. And Alistair's just, like, not really feeling the vibes.
I was gonna say, I think it's important to, like, kind of mention the roles that they kind of have. So Elliot's, like, the youngest, and then Alistair's, like, the oldest, and he's also, like, the clan leader for his gargoyle, so he's a lot more, not studious, but, like, reserved, I would say, and is kind of, like, the dick of the group. And I would say, like, Broderick's, like, a nice midline between those two.
After Grace stormed out of the chapel, Elliot's like, come to dinner or something, or maybe he, like, responds, yeah. Here he texted her and is like, come to dinner. Anyway, Grace agrees to go to dinner at their house, and when she gets there, she has, it's like a long drive too, by the way, they're like in the, like, they're far from where she is, and she's like close to like town or like in the middle of the city. But she gets to their house for dinner, and she sees Elliot, Broderick, Alistair, and then she also meets their, like, parents, I guess, which is Graham and then Eloise. They're not really their parents, but they're like the old clan leader's mates, but they kind of like double as parents, I would say, or like parental figures in that regard. Yeah, and Alistair keeps asking Grace all these questions, like, that are really like probing questions, and it eventually like drives Grace over the edge, kind of, and she's just like, I don't need to deal with this. I don't need all this criticism. Like, I'm your guest, you know, why the fuck are you doing that? Yeah, so that happens, and then Alistair's like, oh, I didn't mean to be rude, I just was asking questions.
Oh shit, wait, did her apartment get broken into?
Yeah, that happens after dinner, I think, and that's when, yeah, they get closer.
She's at home, that's when Alistair comes to save her. Whoa, she gets her apartment, something feels off because her wards are missing again. She's a witch. I don't know how he gets there.
He goes, he knew something was, oh no, I think he was going to apologize, right?
Yeah. He goes to apologize, and she's like, I'm panicking, I'm gonna lose my job. So he like protects her. But Alistair kind of claims her because she's like a doorman who's like kind of worried about her because they're close, and the doorman knows that she's a witch and like kind of keeps an eye out for her. And he tells the doorman, like, this witch is being courted by my clan. I think they want her to move in.
They do, because they don't want her to stay in her apartment, because they're like, it's dangerous here, like, this could happen again. So they want her to like at least stay until like her apartment's cleaned out and like the wards are re-put back up. While she's staying there, she hears, like, she goes out in the hallway, and she hears fucking, like, moaning and groaning. And she's like, what the fuck? She's like, what is happening? So Alistair and Elliot are, like, doing the nasty, right? And they're being loud, apparently, because she can hear them in the hallway.
I don't think they didn't shut the door.
Yeah, oh, yeah, it's cracked open. You're right.
Yeah.
And then while she's like eavesdropping, Broderick like sees
being Tom dog.
No, for real. Broderick sees her and is like, oh, so you like to listen? Wait, I don't, is it the scene? I think it is the scene where he eats her out. Is this the one?
Yeah. Like, yeah. In the hallway. I think in the next chapter, Elliot's like, I can smell her. I was like, you're joking. And he, for some reason, he was like, they both need this. Elliot hurt our clan leader with his deception. This is their time to work that out. And Grace is like, through sex? Like, you guys can't have, like a talk? And I think, again, he gives her a head in the hallway. Because he was like, you just gonna go to your room? Did you bring a vibrator? I was like, you guys, it was like 2 days ago that you just met.
Yeah, the timeline for this book is crazy.
It's so fast.
I think, okay, Grace puts back up the wards in her house, and while she's there, Broderick comes and spends time with her. Like, they just watch a movie, they kind of have, like, just, like, a cozy little cuddle on the couch, and they just have, like, a good old time.
I love him.
You know, he's great, for sure.
You know what we should do? We should do an audiobook, because that's essentially what we do every time we do a plot summary.
Oh, yeah, and he fucks her with his tail, too. It's not really important, again, but yeah. I'm gonna say it.
He has a tail. It's important.
He does have a tail. He uses the tail for salacious purposes.
Broderick Bramblewick is smooth. His name is such a mouthful. I guess not only his name, but they're horny all the time.
They are really horny. They do a lot of horny. There's not a lot of... Mm-hmm. It's quote-unquote plot. So...
quote-unquote plot. And I ate it up. I remember having very fond memories of this book. Like, I really, really enjoyed it when I read it.
It's good. I also agree. And it's really pretty, too, because there's, like, black pages. Oh, my God, we're getting off topic.
I know it is super pretty. That's something that I really, really enjoyed, was, like, the art on the pages, because there's, like, flowers and, like, the black page on every, like, new chapter.
Elliot delivers the fucking salve to her work and, like, applies it.
Oh, my God, I do remember that. Whoa. Horny.
It's just, they're so horny. Like, in her place of work, y'all couldn't wait.
What's her friend's name?
Amelia.
Amelia. Damn, yeah. Like, it's gonna be funky in the room.
Please. No, for real. I'm gonna be like, it smells.
This is Elliot pounding into me with his apology. We can't communicate. Like, we can't.
Use our words.
Like, we're adults. Believe me, I love a good hate fuck, but can we at least have a couple of lines of dialogue? Damn, this is fun.
This is fun.
Oh, in chapter 38, I don't know if you're that far, but they get, like, a little insight into, like, they couldn't trace the magic because it was clear signatures, so they just get, like, a little bit more information. Because I think she's not planning to stay with him, like, she eventually does want to return home. They also want to know who's, like, attacking her or targeting her. The pressure is getting worse.
Grace has been going to work and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and her fucking car gets vandalized. And it says something. I don't remember what it says. It says something like gargoyle fucker or something. I don't know. It says something. But it gets vandalized.
Broad daylight, cherry on top, slut whore.
Oh, it's a slut whore.
And if, as if to add flavor, monster fucker.
Ah. No, because the way I put that on my car, anyway.
Bumper sticker.
I'd be like, wow, thanks for, you know, making my car look better.
Yeah, not the slut whore part, but damn.
Yeah, but the monster fucker, I'd be like, ah. You got me. Especially if I was, you know, I'd be like, ah.
Yeah.
You're not wrong.
Oh, what it is. It is a black pot. Damn. I feel like somewhere in here she gets flowers delivered to her. Do you remember that happening?
But yeah, I think so. I think she's working downstairs and she gets flowers delivered. Or were they delivered to her house? I don't remember.
You know, I feel like we're doing good. We're like more than halfway through the book and it's been like, what, 20 minutes?
26.
That's not bad.
Mm-hmm.
For putting pieces, I feel bad that you're gonna have to edit this.
No, it's okay. It'll be fun. It'll be something to do.
And like the next chapter, we see that Grace does not have like a good relationship with her mother because her mom was like, "You should be grateful that you caught the attention of a man, of someone like him." But I don't think she knows like who it is. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Because I think she's been set up on multiple, like, dates and stuff from her parents. Oh, my God. Some world-building plot points is that witches are, like, very prestigious, and Grace comes from a very prestigious family. I think they were the Starlings. So she comes from a prestigious family, and her mom wants to set her up with another, like, man from a prestigious, like, line of witches to continue the, like, family line. But Grace is estranged from her mother and her parents, like, just not even her parents, but from her mother and, like, her family because she doesn't want that.
Since they're like, we need to protect you, they take her back to their house, and we see, like, they're dead, or, like, they're stoned, like, elders. So she meets Lycan. Lachlan? L-A-C-H-L-A-L-A-N.
Lachlan?
Lachlan?
Grace kind of permanently, kind of quote-unquote, moves in for the time being, and she starts getting close with Alistair, and, like, not really close in the sense that they talk. It's almost that they just spend time together, because, like, Alistair will, like, be reading, and then Grace will just come in and, like, just sit with him and, like, read. Like, they'll either read the same book, read a different book, or just, like, be in each other's presence, but, like, that helps them get closer and, like, get to know each other, and, like, that's just, like, really cute. Yeah, there's oh my god, we learn a little bit about Alistair at some point, too, that and, like, their entire clan is that they were all kind of, like, misfits in a way. Like, Alistair was, I think, I'm gonna say this wrong. Somebody was, like, just thrown away as a child. Like, they were orphaned or something. They weren't good enough. I don't remember why. We just learned that they all kind of don't have parents for one reason or another, they all kind of came together or were, like, adopted by the clan at one point or another.
I think that's why they revere Lachlan so much, because, like, he brought them all together and, like, kind of gave them all a home.
Oh my god, yeah. And when gargoyles die, they don't just, like, die. They just turn to stone.
Yeah, or, like, when they're sick or they need to heal, they kind of crust up a little bit.
Nothing crust up, please. An uncrustable. Oh my god.
I just love peanut butter. Anyway. And I think she's, like, kind of realizing that, like, damn, I really am going to stay with them forever. Because she's like, someday I'm going to bear these marks of being mated, too. So she's like, wow, I really am happy here. Oh, and this is where we start kind of getting to, like, the peak where, like, the plot starts thickening. Because Amelia's mom calls Grace and is like, have you seen Amelia? She's like, she hasn't come home or anything. And she received a call from, like, a man saying that if I want her to stay alive, I should tell you to pick up the call and do whatever they say. So yeah, they have her. I think she goes. Oh no, who the fuck is Mace? Mace is a friend.
Oh yeah, Mace. Okay, he was literally only there for like 2 or 3 chapters. They brought in like this like investigator man, and he just like kind of appeared. I think he's a witch or something. He has some kind of power or something. He's special in some way. I don't know. But they bring him in to help like track down who the person is so that they could get the upper hand. Alistair like brings him in. He doesn't like working with him because he's like flaky. He can disappear, right? I think he can be invisible, right?
I think he can.
Okay. I was like, I'm not crazy. That
sounds familiar. Okay. So what I think the plan was is that they were all going to use Grace as like the bait, right? But they're all going to be hiding in the darkness to get Amelia to protect Grace.
I think he can teleport. I think that's what it is. Yeah. And I think he was supposed to grab Amelia, and then the other ones were going to grab the bad guy.
Yes.
I think that's what happened.
Who's Bradshaw?
He's the bad guy.
You're right. He is a bad guy. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Alistair gets hurt, and he turns to fucking stone. So they think he's dead. Berta's like, he's fine. He'll come back. Like, he's trying to hold Faith out, but everybody's kind of sad that he's taking so long to thaw out.
Because he wasn't just, like, injured. He was cursed with a death curse.
Yeah.
And it wasn't just like, oh, he got a little scratch. Like, he was cursed to die.
Whoa. Oh, my God. They find, like, a letter that Alistair wrote for her, which I think is really, really sweet. Anyway, yeah, so the letter is like, today you confessed your love for my mates, blah, blah, blah. I'm not as great as them. Woe is me. I respect and trust you. Blah, blah, blah. I will let you guys be together if you want. I'm the clan leader. I want what's the best for everybody. I'm late for dinner. Love, Alistair. Blah, blah, blah. And this is his way of telling her that he loves her. But he didn't do this. And I think Broderick gives her the letter. And this is where he wakes up. She's like, fate or whatever gods don't get to take you from me. I need you. She's crying. I love you, Alistair Bramblewick, so you better wake up. The hand on my cheek roughens in texture and crackling sound through the air. I stumble back as stone Alistair shatters with a mighty roar. A little dramatic, if you ask me. But he's back, like, oh my god, I love you, blah, blah, blah. Everybody's so excited that he's awake. They nuzzle. She's just so tasty and hot for us. We fuck immediately, almost.
Where did they fuck in the library that they made for her?
Where is that? I don't know, but I need that scene.
Yeah, we're just gonna mention that here, I guess, because I don't know when it happens, but it does. Epilogue.
Like a sex goddess. Wow. Oh, to be loved.
Who the fuck is Rose? Oh, she's the... Oh, they go back. The epilogue is they go back to the matchmaker, and the matchmaker's name is Rose, and they have to, like, repay the matchmaker because the matchmaker doesn't take money. She takes sex energy as payment. So they have to fuck her matchmaker studio to make sex.
Do they all three go?
I think they all three go, yeah.
I guess all four.
Oh, yeah, all four, yeah.
And, yeah. And then there's a bonus epilogue from Amelia's side.
Yeah, it alludes to Amelia
getting her own story. So yeah, that's the plot summary.
Woo! Only 47
very
minutes.
Shaky. It's a little humbling. Like I said, we did read this a year ago, so give us a little grace.
Put on touch.
I really like this book from a point of, like, offering representation. This was, it's not one of the first, because I do believe that I read a book by A.D. Award, I don't know, I never know how to say her name, it's A.I.D.Y. Award, and she did, like, the Unclaimed book series, so I read that first, but this was, like, also, like, a big toe dip for me in terms of, like, plus-size female main characters. So I really enjoyed it, and I think it was done very well in a way that, like, it brought attention to it, but it didn't, like, make it this large, tense, and stressful plot point.
People have talked about this, like, before in, like, different things, but, like, how certain things in reality that people, like, deal with don't be translated to fantasy, because if you're reading a fantasy book, you want it to just feel like a fantasy. You want it to just, you want to be a part of the fantasy. You don't want these, like, big social issues or big, like, insecurities and things to be emphasized or punctuated within the plot. Like, you just want it to be like, this is a normal person going about their normal life in this fantasy world. And that's how I felt like this book did a beautiful job of that.
Yes.
While still, like, making it, like, come across that, like, yes, she is a plus size woman, but she's, like, just, she's just living her life. Do you know what I mean? It's not like,
she's
like, she's a normal person, you know, like her body isn't her only trait. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I really love that part about it.
I agree. I'm very, like, flippant on this, in that sometimes I am like, oh my gosh, they went with it too quickly, or, like, they're so resistant to it. And I like that there was, like, a little bit of tension, but, like, they were able to talk through it. I feel like I had, like, a good balance of, like, the tension, but also, like, the trauma bonding.
Can we talk about Elliot being a little fucker? Because...
yeah.
How do you just come clean from the beginning, like, about everything? A lot of the issues wouldn't have been, but, like, I understand where he's coming from in the sense of, like, you're worried that people won't accept you or accept, like, your life and the things that it is, or, like, in this case, your other partners, because assuming this world is very monogamous too, and in addition to that, they're, like, gargoyles, and she's a human witch, like, there's a species difference, and I'm sure there's a stigma with that, considering seems Monster very fucker. Yeah, very, like, witches stay with witches, other people stay with other people, blah blah blah. Like, Grace is very accepting and willing to, like, listen, and had Elliot just talked to Grace and had talked to Alistair and Broderick. But it's okay.
I agree.
I guess it built his character.
I guess we got there in the end, but I just think I'd feel a little weird about calling my partner is my brother.
No, for real. Like, even as a lie, I'd be like, ooh, it hurts.
These,
like,
are my friends.
Yeah, I'm like, you could have come up with a different thing, or, like, these are, like, my, I don't know, yeah, like, friends, my roommates.
And he should have known, with how, like, they're pretty sexual with each other, so I feel like if you, like, I guess he didn't know that they're gonna be there, but even if there's, like, a chance of them being there, you shouldn't. Like, I feel like that's a little bit worse. I'd rather know that you have other partners than to think that you're a brother fucker.
Yeah, I do like how this book portrayed, like, open and, like, polyamorous relationships, too. Because we've talked about this before. I personally don't like it when it's, you have one person at the top who is connected to the other people, but the other people aren't connected to each other. This was nice because everyone's kind of holistically connected in one way or another. Even, like, Alistair and, Broderick have, like, this, like, really deep friendship.
Because there's been some other books that I've read where, like, they're all attracted to, like, the one person, and they're not, like you said, like, interconnected. I like that they all are pretty functional couples without each other being present. Because I feel like sometimes in other books there's, like, a little bit of jealousy if they're not all there and present in, like, the things that are happening. Part of the reason that Grace was like, damn, like, I really should say, is we referred to her list earlier, but then she was like, I realized that all of my needs are being met within, like, all three of them. Yeah, this was also my first ever, like, gargoyle book, which was, like, it was a really good introduction, because I feel like prior to this, well, I guess I had read Lily's series, but prior to this it was mainly, like, before I started diving deeper, it was more of, like, a Omegaverse and not so much, like, actual monster, you know what I mean?
Yeah, just for reference, Grace's list. Oh, also, no, let's talk about this. Elliot stole Grace's list.
He did steal her list.
Grace's list was the perfect partner, funny, thoughtful, spontaneous, protective, wants children, passionate about something, book lover, sexually compatible. That was her list, and Elliot snatched it out of her purse. He's a thief.
A thief.
and was like crossing off the things that like he fulfilled and that he thought like the other two could fulfill, and he was like, we'd be the perfect partners.
I think we should also talk about how sexual they are. I like it because it's better than some of the books that I've read in that it does add things to the plot without it being purely just smut. But they do fuck a lot.
Yeah, I really like this book. And it's not too... The thing I liked about it too is after coming off of like Lily's series and stuff, it's not super heavy. Of course, there's like certain aspects that are a little heavier than others in this book, but it overall is pretty light and fluffy. There's not really a lot that's like, oh, somebody's head got blown off, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, that was trauma.
Not too heavy, but there is like some points of tension that do like make it complex and add depth to the story, but not too deep that I'm like, I need to take a moment to like recuperate from this.
You want to go into our readings for the book?
Yeah, that we can do. So what did you give it for plot?
I gave it a 4 out of 5. I thought the plot was really, really interesting. And obviously it had a happily ever after, which I'm always here for. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just really good plot overall.
I also gave it a 4 out of 5. I really liked the plot. Yeah, per. That's all I have to say. Sorry.
What'd you give it for world building?
I gave it a 4 out of 5. I think it did a nice job, like, showing a lot of the monster culture, almost like the ogre and, like, the lizard man and, like, the witch's beef, and also showing, like, a little bit of, like, the gargoyle culture as well.
I also gave it a 4 out of 5. I did think it was interesting because it kind of seemed like it took place in, like, a world much like ours with humans and stuff and, like, another... I love that when things take place in, like, our worlds. But, like, we don't know about it. Like, a secret society of, like, monsters and witches and things.
What did you give it for characters?
I gave it a 5 out of 5. I love Britterick. I wish I had Britterick here with me now. I wish he was mine. Grace is really sweet. We love Grace. Elliot's a little fucker, but, like, he's likable enough, you know? and then Alistair is the tall, brooding, dark and handsome type, and I love that, and he's just really sweet, and he has, like, more development than just that, like, that's his surface level, and then, obviously, we get more in depth as we go along, and I thought all the characters had a lot of, depth, like, within them, and a lot of, like, you could tell how their, like, past really shaped them once that was explained, so I really like that. What did you give it for characters?
I also gave it a 5 out of 5. I feel like sometimes with these types of books where there's, like, so many main characters and, like, the dual perspective, or I guess, like, numerous perspectives, it's kind of hard to give all of the characters depth, but I feel like we really did get that with all of them. I was enamored by Britterick. Like, I love him so much. Throw the hearts up for Britterick. But, yeah, I really like the characters. They're likable. And even the characters who are, like, bad characters and, like, side characters also have, like, a lot of depth and, like, backstories as well, which is interesting. What did you give it for spicy scenes?
I give it a 5 out of 5. I remember when I first read this, like, a year ago, I was like, this is amazing. This is immaculate. Everybody took care of each other. Like, it wasn't just like, oh, we're fucking. It felt very, like, warm, if that makes any sense.
Also gave it a 5 out of 5. I think a lot of the scenes were very well done. I also like that they weren't all, like, some of them were just, like, just quickies, but they were done in a way that it was, like, also, like, added the spice that it needed, because I feel like sometimes they're kind of, like, drawn out. The two scenes that stick out to me are the hallway scene and the library scene. Yeah, so, like, overall, how did you rate the book?
I rated it a 5 out of 5. This is a definite, like, reading recommendation. Like, I would be like, oh my gosh, you want to read, like, something that I've read? Read this book. This may be a lot for some people, like, first off, but I do think it's a good introduction too into, like, monster fuckery. It just has, it has everything that it's, like, a good monster fucker starter pack. It has it all.
Yeah, I agree. I also gave it a 5 out of 5. I love this book. Definitely one of my favorites out of the books that I've, I guess, monster fucker journey that I've been going on for the past year. I enjoy it. Would recommend. Have recommended.
To me.
Yeah. We'll read again in the future. So, yeah.
You know what we skipped over that we always have? The fucking cover.
Oh my gosh.
So, what were your thoughts on the cover?
It was so pretty. It did take me a minute. Like, just looking at it, I was like, oh, this is cute. Because whichever gargoyle is back there is, like, so dark when you first get the book that you really just do have to sit there for a moment and kind of take it in and kind of really see it for what it is. But I love it. It's very pretty. I call it timeless. In that it has like that old vintage vibe that I really like seeing from romance novels. I really, really enjoy this cover. She's beautiful on it, and it's like also giving, like, it alludes to a monster, but like he's not too scary.
No, yeah, for sure. If I just saw this like chilling in a bookstore somewhere, I definitely just like pick it up and be intrigued by the cover. Just very pretty, very beautiful. Ugh, I love good art on covers. We don't have anything next.
All right, so yeah, that kind of concludes our very long-winded plot summary, as well as our thoughts about this book. Goodbye for now, sinners.
See you next time.